It's April 23rd, 2003, and today the banks of Lac Amance in France await the imminent arrival of the fifth World Carp Classic. The team of marshals for this year's event have been handpicked from Britain's Sparsholt College, and the rest of their day will be occupied with pegging swims for the competition. Meanwhile, the Lac Amance site will see a steady influx of anglers throughout the day as they register their team details with the event organisers. One team in particular, who have travelled a great distance to compete in this year's event, have come all the way from Russia. Waterline Angling have kindly provided equipment for the Russian team to use, as travelling by plane has its limitations on what anglers can bring with them. Whilst there's no fishing today, carp anglers can always find something to amuse themselves. Indeed, the pre-match festivities at previous events have proved legendary, perhaps even more so than the competition itself.
If I caught the biggest fish, it's probably going to be my personal best. So that would mean something. I'm pretty happy if I catch a big fish. If it's a smaller fish, I'm happy as well. I'm not fishing that often anymore because I'm very busy with my company. And I'm happy when I'm able to fish. So those few weeks a year, I'm happy. And if it's a big fish, I'm happy. And if it's the biggest fish, even if somebody else catches a bigger one after that, I'm still happy with that fish. So.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. The event is now officially open.
On the morning of the competition itself, Ruben Heaton boss Andy Race briefs the Sparsholt marshalling team on the correct procedure for weighing the angler's catches.
The weighing of the fish, you know, once you've got the fish on the bank, this wants to be wetted first, so wet this first, wring it out, hang it on the scales, zero the scales with the sling on, yeah? Take the sling straight off, get the fish in it, get it back on, get it back on the scales. Way to weigh the fish, you need better if there's two of you with it. You want to start off with the fish on the floor, lift the fish up, just get it just off the floor, take the weight, back down again.
After the customary group photography session, the anglers gather for the all-important peg draw. Even before they know where they'll be fishing, almost all of this year's competitors are full of optimism on their chances.
And where have you come from to fish this year's event?
Winchester in Hampshire in England.
From Germany.
I'm from Sweden.
I'm from Holland.
Who do you think is going to win this year?
Me and Jaime.
Yeah.
We win the competition, yes.
You will win?
Yeah.
We're going to try to do better than the last year, so we're pointing for the winning.
You never know. You never know. We all have the same chance to do it.
And if you do win, what do you think you'll do with the money?
Spank it on bed.
Buy a new car.
The money is for the new tackle. New tackle and for a nice fishing trip.
I think for a new car.
New car.
For carp fishing, yes.
It's gonna be more holidays than fishing.
Yeah, right. Maybe in holiday. Maybe holiday to France.
Hey. Have a few months off work and go fishing in England.
Ой, у меня много планов.
Big plane.
Okay.
Once again, the format for the draw has undergone some changes this year. Anglers now have the chance to ditch their initial peg drawn in favour of another. For some, this will be a choice between success and failure.
109. He doesn't want that one. Peg number 58, that's the one he keeps. Peg number 57. Do you want to keep or ditch?
Ditch.
All right. Peg number 34. Peg number 43. Nope. No, he doesn't want that one. Peg number 96.
Keep it.
He has to keep that one. Peg number 29. No, that's being ditched. Peg number 69.
Nice.
Peg 72. Peg number 93. Peg number 31. 31.
Just
you then. He doesn't want peg number 31. Right, so your peg number is peg number 53.
The pegs have now been decided, and by whatever means necessary, anglers travel to their swims in the hope that their home for the next 3 days will yield a winning catch for their team. If you're contemplating a fishing trip to France, then you could do a lot worse than heeding the advice of Tim Paisley, John Lilly and Bob Brogdon, all of whom have had considerable experience of French carp angling.
I think people get too wound up with, you know, the coming to France. I always say about, you know, I do a fair bit of fishing overseas now, you must treat them as the most pressured fish that you're ever going to come across, because the week you come here they might be. You know, you come here and it's cold, or they've had a hammering the week before. It's no good thinking, oh, I'm coming to France, they're easy fish. Here we go, I'll take anything. You know, whatever you would fish for your pressured fish on the small waters in England, you know, scale your baiting campaign up and, you know, work out where they're going to come through, how far across you've got to go, I mean, we found like just a bit of a drop off in a ridge about 70 yards out with weed there, you know, and it just, you can just sense them skulking along it. Francis fishing, you know, Francis carp fishing. And I think too many people fail because they come to France thinking it's going to be easy, John, don't they?
They do. They don't realise the amount of blanks that people have in France there. You know, you can blank anywhere, but
yeah.
So the water's getting pressured more and more, like Tim said now, and you need to be on your toes all the time against them, like new tactics, change around a bit, do different things.
Loads of pellet, loads of hemp. You know, you've got to try and hold them in the swimming. You can't do it with boilies. You just can't put enough boilers in to hold them because you'll get a big shoal of fish come through that can wipe you out in a quarter of an hour. If you don't get a big shoal of fish come through, there might be too much bait there for them if you're just using boilers.
Right, the rods I'm using are Atchison Strikers, 12 foot 2¾. Nice rods. I use them a lot in France. They hold good. They're a good action rod. They handle the fish really well, to be honest with you. And I wouldn't use another rod out here, to be quite honest with you. Atchison makes a good rod anyway, and as far as I'm concerned, that's the only rod I'm going to use. I've fished France now over 25 years, and I've not seen any reason really to change my setup. Although I fish big pits, I'm not the sort of person that rows baits out at long distance. I can catch fish the same distance here as I can at home, and provide I'm in the right area and the fish are there, I'll catch them. It's as simple as that, really.
At 3 o'clock on April 24th, 2003, the horn sounds, and once again hundreds of leads pound the surface of Lac Amance. It's now anyone's guess as to who will come out triumphant 3 days later. Although this fish is by no means a monster, it is significant. A few hours into the competition, a member of the Dutch Omega team catches the first fish of the 2003 World Carp Classic.
Pounds ahead of anybody else.
11 pounds.
It is the first.
Yeah.
11 pounds.
The sun is setting over Amance, and there were to be no further catches that evening, leaving anglers in the hope of a busy night.
New developments for this current year, and one of those is a very interesting little rig which we've called a critter rig. We have a brand of fluoro boilies which are called critters because they're designed to critically balance your hook bait without hardly having to use any putty or any lead to bring it down. But what we've actually done is that we've got a long shank nailer with a swivel attached to the eye so that you're getting completely 360 degree rotation. And then what we've done is we've got a swivel, a tiny size 14 swivel here, so that everything can rotate and the bait can turn on it, and also the rig can turn underneath as well. And what we actually do is that we put a pop-up on here, and then we can take any bottom bait we want. It could be a great big tiger nut. It can be a boilie, it could be anything you want it to be, as long as it's nice and heavy. And then we just attach that. And we've got a new little device coming out, which we've called Quick Stops. It's a flattened oval ring, which we attach to the hair on a loop-to-loop basis. We just put the loop of the hair through this little gap, and then loop the loop over the top of there, so we've now got a loop-to-loop. and you never need a boilie stop again, because all you do is you attach the boilie, pull it on, pull that through, rotate it on the knot, and that's it. You never need a boilie stop again.
The busy night that many expected never came, so on the morning of day two it's still very much open. Only three small fish were caught during the night, two of them by the Berger brothers from Holland, on peg 49, which puts them in an early lead.
So how do you feel about being in the lead at the moment?
It feels great, yeah. It's a, it's a little bit scary. There's so much people who's fish on the moment. So we are with 400 rods on the moment, so... Yeah, well, if you lead with four rods, it's great, yeah. It feels good.
Last year's champion, Thierry Stunnenberg from Holland, also had a quiet night. But as always, he's confident that the fortunes of his team will soon turn around.
We're very happy with this pack, and I'll tell you why. When you watch to the opposite side of the lake, you see two trees. And the trees, the right and the left-hand tree, mark a road. So when you look that way, you got exactly the same thing. So what we got here is we're fishing on the middle of a road. There's an old road going straight through the lake. It's deeper in the middle, and it's deeper on the outer sides of the road. So we got kind of like a bottleneck where all the fish has to get through in the middle of it. So we're very happy. What happened yesterday night? We didn't sleep for 38 hours. We were a bit lazy. Typical Dutch again. we only baited up our spots with about 600 grams of boilie, just boilie. It was too little. We had one take, so the fish didn't find enough boilies to start feeding, to have a frenzy out there. So that's what happened yesterday. Today we did it completely different. We took about 5 kilos of boilie in about four different sizes.
Three sizes.
And we started baiting up with rockets and spread it all over the place. And we're not fishing now.
Taken out for 3.5 hours. We were ready.
It took about 3.5 hours, yeah, to get it in. We're not fishing now. It's very simple. We tried to explain last year, but people probably didn't understand. We put in the bait. We leave it there. It's because of one simple fact. If one fish finds the bait and he likes it, it's very important, the fish has to like your bait. He starts looking for it. So it's like cows grazing. The carp do that also. You got one fish coming in, you got another fish coming in, you got three fish coming in. What happens if you start fishing right away? You probably hook the first one coming in. As soon as you hook one fish, they get scared and they, particular kind of stuff comes out of its body and it spreads out all over your place, so other fish stay away. So that's why we're not fishing. We want to try to get as much fish as possible feeding on our spots, because we can catch quite some of them. That's what I told the cameraman, you can't see right now. we're gonna catch probably a couple of fish tonight. If we're lucky, we're gonna catch about, well, whatever.
Yeah,
We'll see. We're gonna catch fish tonight. Yeah. Lots of them.
Only time would tell if his predictions were right. With only a few hours of daylight remaining, and no further catches throughout the day, the anglers bait up one last time before settling in for the night. It's near sundown when finally a catch is made. This 28-pound mirror carp fell to the rods of a clearly shell-shocked Chris Smith from British team Fosters of Birmingham. Not only is this the biggest fish caught so far, it also gives the Fosters team a slender lead in the competition.
very pleased. Words can't describe how I'm feeling at the moment. Really happy.
As the sun goes down, they're left to reminisce about the memorable catch and ponder what further successes the night may bring.
Obviously, when you're match fishing, you need to be able to take the gear that encompasses everything you need to be able to do. If the fish are showing at 150, 160 yards, you need to be able to get there and use the gear that's capable of getting you there. The rods I'm using here today are Fox Gladiators, the 13-foot, 3.5-pound Teskers, although they feel a lot more powerful than that. And they're capable of throwing a very big lead a very long way. I've got two different setups on these rods. One of them's a light line setup that allows me to get out to where some of the fish have been shown at about 180 yards. I've got 8-pound main line and a 45-pound ESP tapered leader on the end, coupled with a lead clip, a short hook link and a single pop-up. And obviously the light line on the rods, it allows you to cast a lot further. Obviously, and you need the shock leaders to cope with the power of the rods and the weight of the lead. The other setup, which I'm fishing over a large bed of bait at a slightly shorter range, about 140, 150 yards, is 12-pound main line, and again with a 45-pound tapered leader and a 5-ounce distance lead on. They're big rods and they're big reels. The bigger the reels, the further you'll cast basically. It comes off the spool a lot easier, and the Shimano Big Pit reel fits the bill very, very nicely. I see a lot of people around here with rod pods, and you might notice I'm fishing them on single bank sticks. It's basically, you haven't got to carry so much gear around, and it's just as effective and it's just as stable. The bobbins, I've added some extra weight to them for the trip. Basically because of the distances involved, and obviously if the fish is running back to you towards you once it's picked the bait up, you want a drop back bite to be registered. When you come to a match, you need to be able to get to wherever the fish are. And obviously if you're intending to sort of invest a bit of bait in that particular area, you want to find out what's actually there. And a lot of people, a marker rod's a little bit of an afterthought. If you give it a little bit of thought, you can actually get to where you want to go. Again, this is a Fox rod, a 13-foot, 3-pound Evolution. So it is a beast of a rod, but most fishing rods have got enough sensitivity in the tip to tell you what's out there. I've got a 20-pound sonar braid on as the actual main line. Again, a 45-pound leader. And the setup at the end, got a fairly long tail just in case there's any weed out there or whatever, just so the marker will actually come up at those sort of ranges. A 5-ounce cord, a distance lead, the end of a 45-pound leader, obviously to take the shock of casting the lead, a small bead, and the large ESP marker float. Incredibly aerodynamic, and if you want to get to the sort of range, you know, extreme ranges, they're ideal for the job. Interchangeable flights as well, so you can have different colours for varying conditions. Again, a big Shimano Big Pit bait runner. Again, basically, the big spools allow the line to come off so easily from the spool, especially when you're using braid. You can actually get the distances you need to get to. I'll just talk about the actual the spod setup. Once you've found the spot you want to fish, you need to be getting the bait out there. Unfortunately, I haven't got any of the spods I was using yesterday. We found out they're excellent Xander lures, and a couple of them were bitten off. Again, a big pit, Shimano Big Pit reel. Again, it allows the line to come off very easily. I'm using 6-pound main line on here, so you can get the distance you need to get. The lighter the main line, the further it'll go. It's a rocket rod, again from Fox, 12-foot, 4.5-pound test curve, 45-pound leader, and the spod just tied directly on the end. And you might have noticed that I'm actually wearing a golf glove. A lot of people prefer finger stalls, but I never feel quite connected, and these are ideal. One, when you're casting big heavy leads a long way with a leader, they stop the end of your finger getting sliced off. And two, when you're going at it with a throwing stick, to get the boilies out there, they stop blisters forming on the side of your hand. And for me, I feel a little bit more connected to the line. With any big pit, or a brawl where there's an awful lot of carp in them, they're probably going to be swimming around in shoals. And you need lots and lots of small items in the swim to keep the fish there long enough for you to be able to catch as many as possible from the spot. To that end, the mix we're using here is lots and lots of small items. There's maize, chopped tiger nuts, hemp, mainline response pellets, and about 4 or 5 kilos of crushed and broken up boilies. An ideal spod mix for keeping fish in the swim long enough. The longer they're in there feeding, the more likely you are to actually get a pickup. And it spods very well. The pellets make it quite heavy, so the spod will actually fly a greater distance. And obviously, we've got the boilies. And one thing when you're coming abroad, there's no substitute for quality bait. It's all well and good bringing ready maize that'll last you weeks and months on end, but I've always found, and so have all my friends, that the better the quality of the bait, the more likely the fish are there to stay there and eat it all. These are mainline active maple 8 boilies, and they've been air dried out in the sun for about 2 weeks. One, that makes them absolutely rock hard, and allows you to throw them out the throwing stick very easily, and two, they'll last you for weeks in that form without going off. So if you're actually going to France for a pleasure trip or anything like that, once you've air dried them, don't put them back in a plastic bag, put them back in a bucket, and they'll last you for weeks on end.
Once again, the night failed to yield any significant catches, and the early morning brought in a change of weather and also a new leader. Down on peg 93, a husband and wife team were now in first place with two smaller fish and more substantially a 30-pounder. Even so, the Carp Tech boss Mark Gardner was still being very cautious about their chances.
Basically, when I got here, looked at the water. Obviously done in feature finding. In front of me is a big plateau that I can actually walk onto, which is about 2 foot deep. I plumbed the depth around the plateau, realised there was a channel running from, I don't know, you can't really see it, but there's a channel running into this bay here. And I noticed when I walked round before I started fishing, there was a lot of bream in this bay that was spawning. And I had a hunch that the carp would try and get in there to feed on the spawn. And the channel seemed an obvious route for them to go in. So I baited up initially just 2 spots in the channel and fished 2 at range. And it was in the channel that the first take occurred. I then switched to all 4 rods last night in the channel, and I had a take within 3 hours of doing that. So I was quite pleased with that. Nothing from then on until this morning. Had another take while I was down on my rods. Unfortunately, I lost that fish. But I'm confident they're in that channel, and that's where they're feeding as they come through, and they're trying to make their way to the spawn where the bream have been.
So how do you feel about being in the lead at the moment?
Too early to say, really. Anything can happen. I'm not that much in the lead. I've been told it's only 4 kilo. And the peg over there, they've got access to the bay as well, so it could change. I think they're my nearest serious competitor at the moment.
He needn't have worried, as within hours Mark's wife Jo extended their lead with another 30-pound plus mirror carp.
Big bird drop now.
No, Ben, don't bother. I'm not going to be here. I'm putting back now. Putting that on.
The decline in weather had spurred an improvement in catch rates, with Sparsholt College team Darren Ead and Joel Knight banking another mirror carp well in excess of 30 pounds, putting them in contention for the biggest fish prize.
I had to lose it now.
Meanwhile, the gardeners on peg 93 were edging further in front, and despite this fish being very small, it could be the one that gave them victory if anyone else emerged to challenge them. For the time being, however, they were safely in the lead, as no further fish were caught in daylight. Before sundown, there was just enough time for Mark to put in some more bait, in the hope of keeping the fish in his swim during the night. With the traps now set, the waiting game begins.
Okay, right, due to the size of the venue, I've brought all the distance gear with me. New Vertex rods from ESP, big pit bait runners, loaded up 15 pound line straight through, in case there's any big kippers about, fishing at about between 90 and 120 yards over big beds of hemp. Well, you've got to have something capable of doing the job. I mean, you know, this is only a light breeze on most places at the moment, and when it blows up, it can be pretty severe, so something capable of throwing 4 and 5 ounce leads, something that will stay on the bottom when you get a big blow. And rods, I'd say a minimum of 3 pound test curve. And a reel that can hold a decent amount of line. Right, it's just a selection of the sort of baits we brought with us. Air dried boilies mixed with pellets, which take all the moisture out of the bait if you're away for a long time abroad, especially in this weather. Stops them sweating up and going off. They go very hard because the pellets will absorb the moisture. These are Mainline's Maple 8s and Response pellet. Again, Response pellet with just a mixture of pellets, dry pellets. Something like this will last the entire session. You know, you could take that for weeks and it's not going off. Again, air-dried boilies, Maple 8 boilies. Selection of pop-ups and hook baits. Something for every occasion. Quite a lot of maggots. We've put a base of maggots out, and these aren't obviously aren't going to last the distance, but we've got here and put these out first so that they go down in the silt and hopefully provide a base that the fish will last long, you know, will hang about longer over. And a particle mix of hemp, tigers and sweet corn, and I've soaked this in molasses
and the molasses holds it back and stops it fermenting so quickly. So you're going to get longer out of it. It's going to last you about a week, even in these conditions, kept in the shade. So far we've put out one of these, 3/4 of one of those, one of them, some of them to start with, and if they start having it, then the rest can go in. That's the plan.
It was the last night of the competition, and finally, this was the night that fish would start to appear in significant numbers. The first fish of the night was no doubt the most spectacular, a 48-pound mirror carp caught from one of Lac Amance's islands. The captor was a deliriously happy Hans Sissingh from Holland, and rightly so, as this was the biggest fish in the competition by a long way. Competition was now coming alive as other anglers reaped the benefits of the last night's feeding spell. Nevertheless, it was looking increasingly unlikely that anyone could challenge Mark and Joe Gardner, but their latest catch was this fabulous 43-pound mirror carp.
Yeah, it'll do.
It was now the final morning of the competition, and after the feeding spell of the previous night, relatively few fish graced the banks of Amance in the morning. Nevertheless, these were significant catches in terms of section prizes for their captors.
Hello.
Mate, here's the camera. Do what Rex Hunt is doing. Hold it, do it the other way around. Kiss him. I'm happy.
Okay. Barry, what does this mean? Put in film.
Back on Peg 93, Mark and Joe Gardner awaited the inevitable with the rest of the Carp Tech team, as no other team had even run them close for the 2003 World Carp Classic title. Perhaps some of the good luck was rubbing off, as on the peg next door there was a last minute take for Polish anglers Henrik Pakula and Darius Jura.
Kurde, sam koniec zawodów, ty dos.
Niemożliwe.
Get them rods in there. They've done a good bit of work for me.
You've won the World Carp Classic 2003. Yeah. What are your feelings at the moment?
Absolutely astounding. Absolutely really happy for myself and my wife. Really, really good. Really good, yeah.
Can't quite believe it.
Yeah, she can't quite believe it.
It was all go, wasn't it?
It was all go. Yeah, it's hard at times for the conditions, but, you know, at the end of the day, you're here for the fish, so you put up with whatever you can. And, yeah, really enjoyed it.
And did you ever expect it when you entered the competition?
I had an itch in my palm. And I thought, that means money coming in. And I haven't got no money coming in, so maybe this is it.
And when the fish started coming, I understand there was perhaps a bit of competition between you about who was going to catch the biggest one.
Yes, there was, yes. My wife, definitely, she led with the 31. And then last night, thankfully, 43. But doesn't matter.
And what did you think about getting beaten on the biggest fish?
I don't mind. I'll let him off this time.
This time.
Next time, I'll get the biggest.
And do you think you'll come back and do it again?
100%.
Definitely.
And what are you going to do with the money?
What are we going to do with the money? We've discussed that, haven't we?
Well, not really.
Yeah. Possibly a break, I think. Ibiza for a month in the clubs.
But no carp fishing.
got to have a little bit of time off.